Hey, Mandos, what's up?
This is Johnny. He's my dad's girlfriend's dog. I'm just looking after him for a couple of days. And, yeah, he's going to be here in the background for a couple of videos. But you don't really care about that. This is not what you click on this video. You'll click here to hear me talk about the Mandalorian season finale. And as you can see, I can't really put Slave 1 in its usual place because it's going to bother this little guy. So I'm going to put Slave 1 over here and hopefully I don't break it. In any case, you'll notice that I haven't actually done my Mandalorian Season 2 recap video immediately after I watched the episode for a couple of reasons. The first reason is I didn't want to do a recap slash review video immediately after because there was a lot to take in with this most recent episode of The Mandalorian, the season finale, and I didn't want to just rush into this, if you know what I mean. I wanted to just take a few days to fully appreciate what just happened this past Friday. I needed a few days to kind of get over what just happened. And also, plus, I kind of wanted this last recap for the season to be a bit of a recap and review of the entire season, as well as a recap for just the final episode. So, first of all, the reason why I wanted to take a few days off from talking about The Mandalorian is because I somehow felt simultaneously both satisfied and disappointed by the season finale, and I'll get into exactly why in just a minute. First of all, let's talk about the actual episode itself. The episode itself was great, even without the ending, which I'm sure we'll talk about in length a little bit later in this video. But first of all, it's the culmination of everything that the season has led up to. I mean, I have talked about this whole notion of this season 2 of The Mandalorian essentially being a Star Wars video game, where the main character just goes from place to place. There's a main story, but there's also some side quests and side missions, and then the main character meets all these different characters along the way, and I had a feeling that at the end he's gonna just bring all these different characters together for one final showdown. Now, he didn't actually bring all the characters together. I was expecting to see Cobb Vanth make a return, but it didn't happen, obviously. He did actually went back to get Bo-Katan and the Sasha Banks character, which her name is eluding me at the moment. He also, obviously, he had Boba Fett with him and Slave One and everything. He had Cara Dune with him. And also Fennec Shand. And it was like this motley crew of people going in guns blazing against the Empire. And I really enjoyed that. I loved how most episodes this season played a part in this finale. I love it when season finales do that. I love it when they make every single episode of the season important in a way. Even if it's in such a small way. I don't think this episode quite nailed this, but I appreciated the attempt. And to be honest, I think at this point with what we got in this episode, I think more would just detract from the greatness of this episode. And obviously, first of all, I enjoyed the little mini confrontation between Boba Fett and the other Mandalorian. It kind of proves that, A, you do not mess with Boba Fett, which we already knew, and B, you do not mess with Sasha Banks. Even if your name happens to be Boba Fett. And I love the exchange that he had with Katie Sagar. First of all, I just love the idea that Bo-Katan and Boba Fett are meeting together in live action, having that conversation and confrontation. It blew my mind as a fan of the Clone Wars. And I really liked that. I would have preferred if the fight between the two was a little bit longer, but I guess they had a bit of a time constraint with the episode. So I get why they cut it off as soon as they did. And you know me, I talk a lot about how I don't like the idea that two hero characters, when they first meet each other, they have to fight before they realize it's a misunderstanding. This is not the case with this episode. These are just two rivals, essentially. So I appreciated the confrontation between them. Again, I would have preferred if it was a little bit longer, but that's a really minor nitpick. Then they went with the usual trope, which we've seen a thousand different times in Star Wars. The good guys pretend to be Imperials, in order to smuggle themselves into the Imperial ship or base or whatever, and then take it on from the inside. And we've literally seen that last week with the previous episode, with the Bill Burr episode. We've seen it 1,000 times, and it's pretty much became a staple of Star Wars at the moment. So I'm not really too mad about it. Look at that. Johnny just, I think he heard something outside. Anyways, we've seen this 1,000 times, and I don't really care at this point. It's, I mean, to be honest, it doesn't feel like Star Wars if we didn't have that moment. So I'm not too mad about that. Oh, look at that. Johnny's getting a little bit agitated. It's okay, Johnny. Johnny, it's okay. Johnny, calm down. Johnny, be good. Be good, Johnny. Johnny, be good. Okay, let's get back to the review and recap. So basically, they smuggle themselves onto the light cruiser, and something I really appreciated about this episode is that it showed us the inside of the light cruiser, and it shows us the TIE fighters as they're getting ready to leave. And it's something we've never actually seen in Star Wars, definitely not in live action. Maybe we've seen it in Rebels or something like that. Maybe we've seen it in the video games or something like that. In live action, I don't think we've ever seen that. And that's one of the many things that TV shows within the Star Wars universe can do, because they can focus on these less important things that kind of build up the universe. So, yeah, I really appreciated that. Obviously, I appreciated the mission. I love the fact that he got rid of Boba Fett pretty quickly, because if you know what happens at the end, you know exactly why Boba Fett could not show his face or helmet or armor, for that matter, at the ending. But again, we'll get to the ending at the end, I promise you. So, yeah, I really appreciated something that I didn't even notice at first, but the four main characters outside of just Din Djarin, they're basically storming the castle, and they're taking down stormtroopers left and right. The action was great, and something I didn't even notice until much later, until after I needed some time to think about this episode. Something I really didn't notice, it was all, they were all female, and it never bothered me for a second. I know that these confusing times, it's people get all up in arms when they see strong female characters, but honestly, I love the fact these four women just stormed the castle and they wiped the floor with anyone else, and I didn't mind that one bit. And obviously, it also leads to the Mando's confrontation with the Dark Troopers, and I'm glad there was only one Dark Trooper, because one seemed like more than enough, if you've seen that little fight. And I'm glad that he found a nice way to get rid of all the other ones. But then obviously, we get to the nice dialogue exchange between Din Djarin and Moff Gideon. Now, you know Moff Gideon is not going to be a man of his word. You know he's going to turn on Mando the second he has his back turned. You know what's going to happen, but you still go along with the conversation, because you want to be on Mando's side. You want him to get the child back, or Grogu, Baby Yoda, whichever one you want to call him. So you know he's going to betray him, but you roll with it. And then obviously it leads into the awesome fight with the Darksaber and the Beskar spear. Again, I would have preferred that if it was a little bit longer. It's a bit of a minor nitpick that is kind of a running theme between this episode, and I believe I also said it the previous episode. But again, it didn't bother me too much. I would have preferred it if it was longer, but I appreciated what we got. And then obviously, the transfer of power, the Darksaber. I wonder if they're going to make it an actual major plot point in the next season or later down the road with the upcoming Star Wars stuff. Then obviously, I mean, we gotta talk about the moment, all right? The moment an X-Wing shows up, one lone X-Wing. At that point, I knew where they were going with it, I just couldn't believe it. I didn't believe it until I finally saw the green lightsaber with the familiar hilt and the black hand, and just, it was Darth Vader in Rogue One, but from the perspective of the other side. It was incredible and glorious, and it's even better when he's taking down these Dark Troopers, which we've already seen in that very same episode how big of a threat these things are, and he's just taking them like there's nothing. Because with the Darth Vader thing, I mean, it's a great scene, it's a great moment, but he's essentially taking down rebel forces who basically have no shot whatsoever against him. Same thing with Darth Maul in the final, in the finale of Clone Wars. Same thing here, but in here, we've seen how big of a threat these things are earlier in the episode, so it makes it even more impactful. And then obviously, CGI deepfake Mark Hamill. R2-D2 shows up, and he actually has more to do in this episode than he had in the entire original trilogy, no, in the entire sequel trilogy. Now, I'm not... First of all, let it be said, I like the sequel trilogy. I enjoyed the sequel trilogy. R2-D2 had basically nothing to do in the entire trilogy, and I appreciated that Filoni and Favreau gave him... First of all, I'm glad that they actually included him and his little conversation, not conversation, but little minor interaction with Grogu, and was like, it was kind of, I could feel the wheels turning in his head, R2's head, was like, oh great, another one of these. So yeah, that's basically what I thought R2 was beeping at that moment. But then obviously we got the emotional moment. Din Djarin takes off his helmet. I wonder if he's going to keep his helmet on for the next season, or if he's going to just take it off. We've seen him taking off his helmet earlier this season. So, I kind of wonder... Obviously, he's going to keep the helmet on, because, you know, protection. But he's not going to stick to that old creed of just, no one else can see his face. So, that's at least what I'm assuming. But then, obviously, CGI Mark Hamill takes Grogu with him. And that's pretty much the final shot of the episode, and we'll get to the post-credits scene at the end. So this is the part where it left me satisfied and disappointed at the same time, because on the one hand, great, we got this wonderful, beautiful closure to the Baby Yoda storyline, or the Grogu storyline, with Luke Skywalker, the most powerful Jedi in the galaxy at that time, taking away the child. But I'm not too satisfied with just how it ended. It feels a little bit abruptly. It feels like they kind of left the whole Darksaber part of the episode up in the air. It feels like, I don't know, I don't think we got enough of a, we got the best closure for Grogu, not so much for Din Djarin, which again I'm kind of disappointed by him. And so we're supposed to assume that they just stayed there on the light cruiser, and you know, Boba Fett's gone, obviously. Did Boba Fett just showed up and gave all of them a lift back to wherever they need to be? Does Din Djarin have a new ship? Is he going to use the light cruiser? What's going to happen with Moff Gideon? Like, all these different things. I mean, again, like I said, it was satisfying and fulfillment to see what happened with Grogu. I just feel like they left a bunch of too many loose ends that I'm sure will get resolved in the next episode of whatever. You know what? Screw that. And the trailer for the next season, they're probably going to resolve everything that I have a problem with. But just, I would have preferred if they had closure for all these things in this particular episode. But that's really the biggest criticism I have over this episode, is that they left us in a bit of a cliffhanger while at the same time also closing up the storyline. Then obviously, we see this guy again, back to Jabba's palace, which I was surprised to see. We see Fat Bib Fortuna, who's now become the new leader of the Hutts, which I really appreciated that. I loved that they actually did that part. I'll fix it later. But yeah, and then also, again, Boba Fett, being true to his name, taking out everybody, and I thought he was just taking revenge for Jabba's minions kind of leaving him in the Sarlacc pit. Nope. He's not up for revenge. He just wants to be the biggest, baddest boss in Tatooine. And considering we haven't exactly seen anything related to Tatooine in any of the sequel stuff, or even just canon material after Return of the Jedi, or at least after the time period of The Mandalorian, who knows what Boba Fett is up to? And who knows what him and Fennec Shen are doing? And it's nice that it's nice that we finally get. We're also going to get Fennec Shen in the Bad Batch show, which I'm super excited to see. And obviously, I gotta take this moment to talk a little bit about. I'm pretty sure I'm gonna get this name wrong, but Jeremy Bullock. I hope I'm getting the right name. If not, I'm gonna put the correct name right above my head. He was basically the original Boba Fett in the armor in the original trilogy, and he recently passed away this week. And it's kind of sad that we lost David Prowse, the guy that portrayed the original Darth Vader in the original trilogy, and the guy that portrayed the original Boba Fett. We lost both of them in the span of 2 or 3 weeks. So, yeah, it's a little bit sad, but as we can see, obviously, Disney didn't really plan this, but obviously, the legacy of Boba Fett lives on in the Book of Boba Fett. Now, what is the Book of Boba Fett? I'm not sure. I have this minor theory that that's going to be the next season, that we're going to take a break from Din Djarin for at least a season or two. We're going to have one standalone season with just Boba Fett and Fennec Shan on Tatooine. Maybe a season of Bo-Katan and her people. And then, eventually, at some point, we're going to get back to Din Djarin. We're going to have this reunion with him and Grogu. And, yeah, we're going to get all these stuff. I've seen a lot of people complain that they didn't do the moment of Din Djarin with, like, the ball from the ship. I have a feeling they're saving it for a possible reunion. They're like, after they haven't seen each other for a couple of years, Din Djarin's not sure if Grogu even remembers him, and pulls out the ball, and Grogu just force grabs the ball from his hand. So, yeah, this is my thoughts on this season finale. I loved it. It still is not my favorite episode of the season. Again, my favorite episode of the season, and the entire show, as a matter of fact, is still the Ahsoka Tano episode, and I explain exactly why. In that recap video, it's not just the Ahsoka Tano stuff, it's the iconography, the samurai versus the Western sort of imagery in that episode, which obviously we didn't get in this episode, but I still, this is a worthy entry to the pantheon of Star Wars content, and I'm so glad as a fan that we have something this great as a finale of a TV show that no one thought. I mean, people were excited for the Mandalorian, but no one even dreamed it would be as great as it is, myself included. So, yeah. And just quickly summarize the entire season. This season is easily better than the previous one, mostly because I'm a little bit biased, because season one mostly showed us new original stuff, and while I love those, it's great we get some new original stuff. First of all, I mean, a Baby Yoda just to start off the season, and obviously another IG droid and Quail, all of that stuff. I really enjoyed all the new stuff, but I also enjoyed the returning stuff, and I think that's a little bit harder, because when you're introducing new stuff, there's less stakes involved. When you're bringing in stuff from previously existing material, like Cobb Vanth, Bo-Katan, Boba Fett, obviously Ahsoka, obviously Luke Skywalker. When you bring in those familiar things into this show, there's more potential to ruin it. And I think it was more risky to bring in the old stuff as opposed to introducing new stuff. That's my opinion on this. And I think they handled it beautifully. I think Star Wars is in very safe hands with Favreau and Filoni at the helm. So, for those reasons and more, I think this season was definitely superior to the previous season, and I can't wait to see what they're going to do in the next season, whether it'll be Boba Fett centered, whether we're going to see Din Djarin again, are they going to resolve the whole Darksaber storyline? We'll just have to wait and see. And, well, that's basically all I have to say at the moment. So, from me, from Boba, and from Johnny, who has been very useful, very helpful in this review. This is easily the longest Mandalorian review that I had. And it warrants it. I mean, it's a season finale, so it's natural that it'll be about 20 minutes long. So, yeah. This is all I have to say about this episode. What did you guys think about this episode? What did you guys think about this entire season? Please let me know, and I'm curious to hear your thoughts. And I will see you guys, hopefully, in the next season, whichever main character is going to be in it. So until then, everybody, this is the way. Hello again, everybody. I really hope you enjoyed this video, because I really enjoyed making it.
So, if you like what you've seen here, please remember to like, share, comment, and subscribe for more awesome content like this. So, until next time, guys, I'll see you guys next time.